Hi, everyone. I am so excited to be here today and a part of today's conference. It's hard to find time to invest in our career, and I appreciate everyone attending to learn something new. And I'm sure that our guest speaker can help us out with that today. I'm Jeff Livingston with ADP Canada. You might have heard our Insights at Work podcast, of which I host every couple of weeks. When asked to introduce today's financial expert, I couldn't have been more flattered. When researching topics for our Insights at Work podcast about payroll, payments, and finance, I'm always reaching out to Khadir. His expertise in this very niche area of finance is unmatched, and I'm very grateful not to just have him as a colleague, but a friend. Khadir Ahmed is Vice President for Canada Payment Operations at ADP. Having spent most of his career in payments and financial services, he now leads a national team of Canadian associates with leadership of payment processes, high-risk collection, and exception handling related to $147 billion of annual client payroll funds and related disbursements. With over 18 years of experience in the financial services industry, Khadir is passionate about engaging others on payments, innovation, and modernization. So without further ado, let's dive in.
Great. Thanks so much, Jeff. Really appreciate that warm introduction and looking forward to presenting in the Payments in Practice stream today on the future of payments. So let's get started. So why we're here today? So obviously, you know, you can see there, Jeff presenting at home. I'm in the office today. So the way that we're working, it's changing, right? You know, we have a number of people working from home. Some people working from the office are starting to. And we look at payments, there's just as much change happening on that side. So if we think about aspects of non-traditional payments, there are lots of changes happening there. And I think many of you have seen that. If you think about your day to day, if you're going to the store now, the number of checkouts for using touchless pay, where you're actually using your cell phone or using, you know, tap to pay, is increasing exponentially. And non-traditional payments are decreasing, right? If you think about some geographies like Australia, you know, they foresee in the next few years that the physical paper currency and coins are going to be gone altogether. Some academics predict that in the next 2 to 3 years. And if we look at as well, just even the changes from the perspective of Canada and workers in Canada, you know, a number of people are working now to remote work, and that's becoming increasingly common. If we look at what that means from a security perspective, there's changes there. If you think about having protocols where you're sort of protecting aspects of what you do in the office, how does that look when you have people that are working from home environments? What types of security protocols and processes do you need to have in place when you're talking about remote environments? So that's another one just wanted to talk about in terms of these changes that are happening from an industry perspective. And then a final point, these are just some quick summary points on just this aspect of the change happening in the industry and progress and some of the topics that we're going to be going through in a little more detail today. Artificial intelligence. So if we think about automation and aspects where we have, you know, a workforce that's potentially at home, but there may be some processes still that are required, perhaps utilizing more in-office type stuff. How do you get that digitization, automation, so we don't have to have aspects where you're dealing with manual forms, as an example, where you're doing signatures, moving to e-signatures and things like that. And that's sort of a first step. But if you take the next few steps in terms of artificial intelligence, how do you actually get that intelligence is actually routing, doing emails, potentially talking to your clients as well? And so that's where we start to get into these things. And certainly the investments in artificial intelligence have also skyrocketed since the pandemic has started, and now over the last year or so. So we'll talk a little bit more about some of these things. I did want to start off with giving an intro to a few terms in terms of payments and payment options defined. So One of the aspects here is the pay card. If we think about Canadian banking, 99% of people are banked by one of the major Canadian banks. But if we look at other geographies, particularly in the US, you have actually a population that may not be banked. So ADP does have products around pay card as an example, whereby you can actually get paid on a card by the employer. So this is something you can use for transactions and other things as well. So it functions kind of like a debit card, but it's not connected to a traditional bank account. So that's one non-traditional payment, just as an introduction. Mobile payments, of course, is becoming huge in terms, I'm sure a lot of you are doing your shopping. I know for myself, this pandemic means a huge amount of Amazon boxes at my door. And, you know, I'm doing things to pay, not necessarily entering in my credit card number each time. I may use PayPal, I may use another thing. Like Apple Pay. Maybe I'm doing groceries to my door. I'm using a service for that. I may use Apple Pay for that. So mobile payments is becoming more and more frequent for these types of payments. And of course, a digital platform as well to manage that. So I talked a little bit just there about PayPal to manage a balance. I might have a virtual balance through PayPal that I use for payments, or Venmo in the US. So that's certainly something from an online account perspective where we're seeing more of that. And the last one is cryptocurrency. So cryptocurrency, we'll always think of in different ways, whether it's Bitcoin, your Ethereum, any number of cryptocurrencies exist. And it is becoming more common to see those non-traditional payments in terms of crypto as well being utilized, even for payroll in some cases. We've seen some companies where they're actually allowing you to get paid. And all of these things really speak to that aspect of flexibility, right? The aspect of what employees are expecting in terms of flexibility when it comes to pay is changing. And so we're dealing with a landscape that's increased exponentially. So it's not just one type of pay potentially an employee can expect, but many. And as employers, as companies that are operating in this digital age, we need to think more expansively in terms of those types of things. So with that, I'm going to pass it back over to Jeff. We're going to start talking a bit more about some of the data behind some of these topics that we're talking about. So over to you, Jeff.
Sure. Thanks, Khadir. Khadir, as part of ADP Canada and a global company, we are so lucky to be sought after as this thought leader in payroll, HR, and finance. And it's because of this that we could dedicate resources to research. Now, you might have seen media coverage covering our national employment report every month. And you might have heard our workplace insight studies covered by the media or even our podcasts. These are all topics that and research that really impact the Canadian workplace. Now, one of our most successful research studies took place in 2019. Now, the ADP Research Institute conducted a survey with nearly 7,000 employees and employers across 13 countries to assess their perceptions of pay methods, pay cycles, and elements of financial wellness. And the survey results revealed that, as in all other aspects of our lives, employees want more choices, they want more flexibility, and they want the ability to access pay as they need, and they also want security. So here's a quick summary before we get into some really specific stats about what the research showed. So it showed direct deposit is king, certainly in Canada. It showed that the usage of non-traditional payment options are low relative compared to direct deposit. It showed that payment options, they're an excellent recruiting and retention tool. Employers believe pay can have an impact on talent acquisition and retention. And you'll see that the stats, well, employees agree with that as well. Of course, security is paramount. And it shows that there is that demand for more options, that gig workers want options, salaried workers want options, and hourly payroll employees want options as well. So let's dive into the stats just a little bit more. And as an example, I know that the stats showed that 79% of employees were paid biweekly or semi-monthly. And in other countries, well, monthly pay is more common than that. So in North America, we know that being paid biweekly or semi-monthly is most common. Pay cycles are problematic for a lot of segments in the working population, including those lower income workers who they might not hold a bank account. Now, if paid with a paper check, these workers, they may need to pay expensive check cashing fees, or they're going to risk expensive overdraft fees due to the time it takes to wait for that check to clear. Now, it's not surprising that 52% of US employees without a checking account say that they would pay a small fee for early access to their earned money once a month or more often, compared to 19% of those employees who have traditional accounts. So this is really a great tool to engage those employees. Now, interest in off-cycle pay, it's not just limited to specific lower socioeconomic segments. For example, over 50% of US employees with a personal income of over $75,000 say that they would pay for early access to earned money at least once a year, most commonly for possible emergency or possible unexpected resources. So there certainly is a market for this out there. Now, demographic and generational trends, they're expected to drive a shift in worker pay preferences. And we've seen this. Millennials, for example, they're accustomed to the immediacy that technology provides them and the flexibility of digital payment options. Khadir talked about that earlier, his Apple Pay. By 2025, these millennials will make up 75% of the global workforce. And now that members of Generation Z, that's people being born after 1996, have started to enter the workforce, employers are going to see the pressure and they're going to see this final crossover to a fully digital work environment, one where employees are true digital natives, one that where employees have never known a world without smartphones or social media, like possibly me. I don't know about Khadir, but I know that I remember a day when we didn't have social media and when we didn't have the internet. I just look super young. Now, pay in the form of compensation has an obvious impact on talent and recruitment and retention. Nearly all employers recognize that this is more far-reaching than pay itself, and it extends to pay as a perk. Now, globally, almost 80% of employers say that they need to customize payment options in order to remain competitive. And we see that in the war for talent. And many agree that they themselves have seen the need for different payment options. So when we're making decisions about paying, how we're paying our employees, the ability to pay, to customize our payment methods for different types of workers, like gig workers, let's say, for example, it's really important as a financial executive to really be aware that my staff and my team and our vendors, they want options. Now, what's really interesting for me when I look at this slide is I look at that 63% stat, and it reminds me how those different payment options help the employer address that gig economy worker. Khadir, when you're looking at this slide, is there anything that really jumps out at you?
Yeah, absolutely. I mean, I think the data speaks for itself. When we think about employees that are new to the workforce, so even existing employees, these types of options are becoming increasingly important. So having that flexibility to give someone options on how they get paid is becoming more and more a default aspect of how people expect their options to be presented when it comes to pay.
Yeah. Okay. So now when we look at the next slide, what's really interesting when we look at these stats is that employees and candidates who are researching employees, they're looking at different perks when they want to join an organization. And what I thought was so interesting is that they're looking at commute time. They're looking at, you know, what are the benefits provided? And they also look at, and this study that we conducted with those 7,000 employees and employers also showed that they're looking at different payment options and what's available to them. So it just really reinforces how important it is that if I'm a CFO, if I'm a controller, if I'm a director of finance, if I'm a director of HR, that I want to have, you know, I want to have a variety. I want to have a toolkit available to me that I can customize to my employees that's going to make offer them different options. Another thing that this survey showed, and I'm going to wrap up my part with this, and I thought was so interesting, is that when we look at just beyond payment options, advice on how to manage expenses is also a different differentiator for talent. So over 60% of employees indicated that advice related to managing healthcare costs, to talking about retirement planning, to talking about debt management, along with other management tools. If we make that available to employees, it makes a difference when they consider evaluating possibly working with one company versus another. And I know that, Khadir, you're going to talk about this later on today.
Absolutely. I think, you know, the data speaks for itself. There's lots of change happening. And I think we really need to address that and talk about what we can do to help support that change. Thanks so much, Jeff, for presenting that data. I think it's very compelling and it definitely leads well into our next few sections here. So really, I mean, we talk about those changes that are happening. It really talks to the changes happening. If we think about COVID-19 impact on the world of payments, we talked about this aspect of a cashless society. So, you know, if we're looking at contactless payments, and this aspect of how you utilize that maybe to reduce aspects of where people are handling physical currency. You know, many retailers, of course, closing their doors to do things and having to sell exclusively online. I think we've all seen the stock prices for Amazon and a number of other companies where they've been able to do that and have done extremely well. We've also seen the other aspect where people haven't done that too well and they've sort of fallen behind. And I think there's lots of proofs of that as well. So that aspect of pushing to a cashless paradigm is becoming more topical than it ever has been before. As well, on the second piece here, just in terms of tighter cash flow management, you know, there's a general scrutiny of all outgoing cash flows likely to increase on that perspective. You know, if we look at aspects of payment instruments like direct debit and reoccurring card payments, that's likely to shrink. And we'll be seeing other things. If we think about payments modernization, if you're familiar with all the stuff that Payments Canada is doing, working with the banks, working with stakeholders, there's going to be new things like request to pay, a way of you actually requesting a payment rather than just sending payments. So we're going to see these tools that are allowing essentially greater control on how cash flow is managed, as well as we look at more forecasting and dashboards. You know, I think Jeff was talking about this aspect on financial wellness and being able to track a lot of these data, this data as well. But the health for a business is aspects on expenditure forecasting or, you know, having dashboards with sweep loan and saving features, right? So having a view on that from a transaction banking perspective is also very important. I've talked about that aspect on online shopping. I think everyone here can, you know, be guilty to say, hey, I've probably been spending maybe too much online. It is very easy. And the retailers have been successful, have made it absolutely easy to do so with one click and getting things, you know, within a day or two. I know for myself, groceries has been a big thing, right? How many people find that tedious to go to the grocery store and, you know, do their grocery shopping? And I think the interesting thing about this, you know, regardless of a pandemic, I could see myself utilizing this going forward because it does save time. It's a great client experience. And so we're going to see more and more of these things happening. And there's also the aspect of the Internet of Things, right? As we look at our devices being more enabled, and, you know, we think about the cell phone, but what about your fridge also being able to detect when you're low on a particular item and then immediately placing that order to the grocery store? So that's going to be where we're seeing some of that future direction. And as well, I mean, so that's the exciting side in terms of innovation. You know, there is a drop in global payments right now. So, you know, likely from a service provider perspective, there'll be a decline in fees associated with that. You know, if we look at pay tax in the industry, they're going to feel the pinch more than anyone else as people are looking at to work with low risk environments and so on. So the funding environment is becoming less friendly. So there's definitely a changing dynamic. With that, you know, we'll have to adjust and change as we're looking at the fintechs operating in that space. And there might be opportunities as well for partnerships with financial providers in that sense, where they can utilize the scale that they have to reduce the amount of risk. So those are some of the things we're seeing in terms of an industry perspective on what's happening. So let's apply this to payroll. As ADP, as a human capital management company, you know, we help a lot of our clients with payroll. And if we look at what's happening in the industry, furloughs have resulted in unprecedented payroll activity. So a lot of furloughing amongst clients where they've had to do that based on changes that are happening. In some cases, you know, we've had to deal with very high volume requests on things in much shorter timelines to help our clients in terms of, you know, helping their employees getting paid and managing some of the challenges that they've had during COVID-19. You know, if we look at some of the things some companies have faced, beyond furloughs, there's also terminations, unfortunately, and that's been increasing. So how do you manage all of that? Of course, there's all sorts of payroll implications when we talk about that. So it's managing all of these pieces. You know, it's as well, when we look at all the changes from a government perspective and you're managing all of these announcements that are coming, how does that manage into your payroll processes, right? We've had a number of things in terms of government subsidy announcements and, you know, interesting, you know, if we look at, as a summary, 154 separate government announcements, and that's a huge amount of complexity to try to manage, right? And figure out where's the right data, where should I be looking for this? We've seen employer financial aid programs, you know, WCB employer premium deferrals, right? And as well, lots of programs, if we think about in terms of provincial programs, territorial, you know, programs countrywide in terms of emergency and pandemic pay, that's become interesting. So as we think about, you know, employees in the midst of all this, right? And I think, you know, Jeff brought up a lot of this stuff around access to pay. You know, how do you help them with aspects of emergency or pandemic pay, right? Someone may need to pay a bill immediately. They may need access to funds in a non-traditional sense. And how do you make it easier for them, really helping them with their individual needs? Because we know that, you know, everyone is going to have a different situation as we face something like this that is so globally changing. So how can we present more options for them to help them in those situations that they need? We think about financial wellness in terms of, you know, planning for vacations or car payments or things like that. These are the regular things. But what do you do when you're in a pandemic and someone needs funds immediately and they're waiting for that next paycheck, or they may have to go to that payday loan that they don't want to do? How do you make it more accessible to them? So it's definitely a changed environment, and we need to present our employees with other options. So let's talk about the future of pay and payroll in general. You know, an interesting fact here, because I always love the statistics. I love the stuff that Jeff had put up in terms of the data that the ADP Survey Institute has generated. It really helps with adding to the discussion. But if we look at aspects on digital transformation, we talked a little bit about that. You know, as much as 40% of the payroll administrator could be automated over the next 5 years. And that's crazy to think about. If you think about a payroll administrator, all the things that they're managing, you know, how does that look? And so really it means that, you know, low value work, those things that an administrator might do, essentially gets removed. But the aspect of higher value work gets pushed ahead. So this aspect of how does that payroll professional actually work then alongside these machines and bots? So a very interesting statistic there, and it definitely speaks to the future of pay and where things are going. So let's talk about some opportunities for change. So of course, you know, if you have automation, you have digital transformation happening, this idea of working along a machine or bot is there. So as an example, if you think about a call center that's in the midst of this and all these government programs and you have clients calling you, this aspect of helping from a self-service perspective is increasingly important, right? If you're thinking about calling in to a call center and you get someone on the phone, the waits for some of these things with some clients, it can be upwards of 30 minutes, an hour. Think about how that might impact someone who's feeling that pressure based on all these things happening, a huge amount of complexity. you know, how do I get my people paid? And so this aspect of working along machines and bots is a great use case in this situation. You know, the potential to have a bot call someone and now give them the information they need, provide them with some of that self-service information becomes interesting. Just to give a personal example of that, because we're, of course, very involved with these types of technologies, I was listening to a call that we had where someone was talking to a bot, you know, and the bot, of course, is doing the inflection. Hey, is now a good time to talk? Talking to the client, gave them the information after being validated, of course, because the security is a very, very important part of this. And then at the end, the bot said, you know, after they were sort of concluded, have a nice day. And the person's like, have a great day as well. So it was a very human interaction for a bot and a human being in this case, right? Where the person's wishing the bot to have a nice day. But that's this aspect now where you've addressed a client's need immediately. And the technology is good enough that it's essentially doing all the right things, even to the point of the interaction. So amazing, right? Where things are going. Of course, this aspect of increased digital focus. So we're looking at how we can put more automation in place through digital processes. Now professionals, if we look at the payroll professional, rather than doing the low value work, stuff that takes up time and doesn't necessarily add as much value as wanted, they can now prioritize value added work. How do we help you know, our employees with all the different things that we need to do? And this is where that strategic arm of HR now gets more a greater ability to help. So we talk about financial wellness programs or being able to focus on other ways to do pay. We can spend more time of that with some of this automation. So it's exciting. And then as we think about aspects of getting additional insight into your workforce through better better information and dashboarding, or enhancing the decision making so we can make the best options for employees. And that really goes to the employee experience. You know, payday is a very, very important day. And it's more so now, if you think about the pandemic, or you think about the workforce that's changing, people want to know when they're getting paid, you know, make sure it's a seamless process. Because they may need to utilize those funds immediately in some cases. And so it's very important that we make sure that it's an invisible process in terms of everything goes right. And if something does go wrong, that it's addressed immediately. And the intuitiveness of that, the ease by which we do that is very, very important. And that's going to be you know, important as we think about retaining and attracting talent, because the worst thing in the world is if someone doesn't get that pay or if they start a new company and it's not happening in a very seamless fashion. So we'll talk about some trends within the industry. And I think we've talked about some of these, but I think it's great to just sort of summarize these payroll trends to watch. That aspect of artificial intelligence, we look at that statistic we looked at for the payroll administrator, we need to embrace it. That sounds scary when you think about the perspective of, oh, some stuff that I'm doing is now going to be automated. But you think about the type of experience you can create for your employees, making things much easier for them. Now I can focus on putting other strategic programs in place to basically help retain and attract new talent to the organization. It becomes very exciting as we think about the types of things we can do when it comes to automation and utilizing payroll data to make better decisions and help the organization. We talked about sort of this aspect on conversational AI, this aspect where the AI is talking to chatbots is another one, of course, where you can get immediate help typing in your question, getting those immediate answers. This is another aspect of convenience that this new world is generating, where those non-urgent requests can be addressed. And of course, you know, you still want to speak to someone, you can also do that too, and then get someone immediately on the phone. So the gig economy, of course, this is increasing. You know, we're seeing technology being an enabler to work from anywhere, right? If we think about our workforce now working from home, people are basically able to do more. You potentially, in some cases, as we look at the shift and this dynamic workforce, they can handle more opportunities. And managing temp workers is an important part of that. So looking at work progress, issuing payments on time, maybe on the completion of a project. So this gig economy and managing that in a very seamless fashion is extremely important, certainly important for our company to be able to help employers manage through that. Financial wellness, if you start thinking about all these non-traditional pay options being leveraged, if you think about aspects of early access to pay, and just to define that, early access might be, you know, similar to if you think about your Uber driver does your drive for you. And essentially at the end of the drive, I can request pay. So I can request access to funds that I've earned. So now apply this to a corporate environment, let's say. So I may be paid in a cycle of every 2 weeks and I want access to my funds within this first week. So being able to access funds is an aspect of flexibility. But then the financial wellness part may be a part of that, right? Because when we think about a two-week cycle, let's say for your pay, or maybe it's mid-month, it's almost a forced financial wellness in the sense that I can't spend until that pay is there. When you start increasing options and non-traditional pay for an employee, we have to think about the financial wellness aspect. And a lot of companies have aspects of that, but when you're starting from where, you know, the payroll, the pay gets assigned, this aspect of financial wellness being applied right at that moment becomes increasingly important. And so it's very important that there's some aspect of a financial wellness program in the system to really help with counseling, help give guidance on topics, important ones like retirement, or how they can help allocate money for those goals that they have. Pay transparency is absolutely becoming very important. We talked about the importance of payday. There's also a lot more transparency across people at work. People are sharing, you know, how much they're making. You know, how do you build in aspects of fairness and equality in how you're doing pay? So these aspects of dashboards, we talked about that. Jeff mentioned it as well, is very important, right? Are we paying equally across the organization, across all the different types of people within the organization? We need to ensure that we have no biases within. So, you know, if you think about transparency, having the data available to be able to do that type of analysis is extremely important, because it really speaks to the value of company culture and how important it is for the company in terms of fair treatment and pay. And that ultimately impacts your brand image. So it's very important. As well, around improved data security. So ADP has spent a huge amount of time in terms of compliance. The organization I belong into as an ops organization is actually in compliance solutions, because it is that important, that focus on making sure that pay is protected at the highest level. We think about cybersecurity, and we think about the pandemic in terms of how things have changed, right? With flexibility, with aspects where pay is moving faster, we have to ensure that employee information is protected. You know, all aspects of sensitive information is kept confidential. And looking at aspects like dual authentication and other aspects are going to be very, very important when we think about fraud prevention techniques to basically remove any of that aspect of fraud. I think with fraud, it's always this aspect of, you know, not if it will happen, it's when. And so how well is your organization prepared to handle aspects around data security? And that's where a good partner definitely helps. So I wanted to talk about digital a little bit more. One great view I think that helps is looking at a digital maturity model. So if you think about some of these things in payroll trends, you know, you can start to think about how your own organization maps. And I know this is a little bit of an eye chart, so I won't read this word for word, but I think what I want to explain here, and this is basically a Gartner current and future technology and service, when we think about AI and analytics, essentially measures the maturity of an organization. So every industry is going to be different, of course, around this. You know, if you look at sort of basic functionality, if we start sort of on that bottom level there, you know, email and using a web mobile app might be the sort of the basic aspect. you know, as we look at sort of the rising, it's this aspect of, you know, click to chat or some aspect of web chat functionality. You might have some aspect of robotic process automation or RPA for those who are familiar with some of these terminologies. And then you go to more to leading, right? You have more enhanced self-service functions. And this is where you have, you know, case tracking and all this integration of these tools. And then finally, you had the frontier is this aspect of Internet of Things. It could be augmented technology. Virtual reality is another thing, of course, when we talk about this aspect of the new world and what people are getting used to. So you can see there as we look, and then AI, of course, you know, you can see there the sort of aspect of how you can track over a number of years. So if we look at how these track and sort of look at a leading organization, you know, this aspect of providing more self-service and creating more digital opportunities for your workforce and expanding on that, you know, these are all steps, right? If you think about infrastructure and technology, you know, this aspect is sort of a stepwise introduction to different aspects of technology as you go, but it really requires a foundation that you build off. You can't really get from basic to a frontier. You're really essentially building in these types of technologies as you go. And so for us, I mean, it's been useful as we look at some of these, you know, a thing like a digital maturity curve, because it kind of, you can essentially track, you know, a particular business unit, a particular function, or the organization itself on this path to see how you're progressing, and then, you know, sort of assessing to see where you potentially could add new capabilities to provide those new opportunities for clients. You know, it's a data-driven world. It's one where there's increasingly more automation with some of these things. So how do we help with, you know, these aspects of employee requests around things with these types of technologies? So this can be a useful view that we've used in terms of tracking the types of things we should be offering in terms of artificial intelligence or digital transformation in general. So if we look at, we talked about the gig economy, you know, let's talk about a little bit more on the trends around that. So if we look at aspects, let's take a particular use case where you have workers that may be cash poor, you know, they're paid bi-weekly. You know, there's aspects of overtime with their, you know, this aspect of, you know, here's a good quote. Most of our couriers are picking this up as a second job to pay for an unexpected expense, right? So you think about this workforce that has varying needs. You know, depending on your situation, that paycheck is extremely important, right? I have bills to pay, or I might be working multiple positions. And that statistic of working multiple positions is quite high, right? If you can, and we can refer back to the ADP Survey Institute in terms of things like that. You know, as well, we talked about that changing workforce. So recruitment, retention issues, right? How do we attract people into some of these positions, right? And here another quote, we're a commodity business, so any way that we can differentiate ourselves from our competitors is good. So if you have a competitor that's offering more flexible options around pay, easier access to pay, it definitely makes you stand out, right? If you think about this workforce that potentially is waiting a long time for a payment, I make that easier. What does that mean, right? As well, if we look at some of these trends in terms of temp workers, sometimes there's aspects of, you know, how do you make sure that you have a workforce that's filling in those shifts and you're managing unexpected absences? So that's an aspect of the complexity around the gig economy. If you think about workers that are doing hourly pay. So we get into faster payments, you know, greater access to money, the worker satisfaction around that, and of course, improved recruitment and retention as well. So lots of stuff on that side in terms of the types of things that the gig economy is looking at. I'm going to move quickly because I want to make sure we're leaving enough time for all the topics today. But financial wellness, we've talked about it. You know, companies are looking for that aspect of financial stewardship from you know, the employer and making sure that those financial wellness recommendations are there. Employees are getting more comfortable with companies utilizing their personal information to be able to provide those types of value-added services. So, you know, a lot of statistics here, if we look at North America or US and Canada, being that, you know, the US and Canada has some aspects where things are different. You know, these are all very, very important if you look at an overall North American perspective. We talked about pay transparency. I'm going to move quickly through this because we've really talked about a lot of these. This is just really summarizing it. Again, this new generation, payday is extremely important. That transparency around it is extremely important. So, you know, as we look at different types of accounts, this mobile digital, digital platform, mobile wallet, all these things are very, very important. As we look at the millennial generation, you can see here in the yellow, these are all very high in terms of the want around these options. Data security. So, you know, these are just summarizing again, a lot of the areas, you know, if we think about aspects of data security, it's not, so it's not the aspect of if it will happen, it's when, you know, you, as an organization, you need to always review your current processes, make sure you're reviewing it on a regular basis because processes are due to change. So whatever your attestation process is, whether quarterly, annually, biannually, make sure you're reviewing those processes, make sure everyone's following the processes, particularly as we look at the pandemic, right? People are now at home. So that's a change in a process. How does that affect everyone making sure that they're following all the due diligence they need to? You know, now as well with employees at home, what are they sharing on social media? You know, are those things that shouldn't be shared? That's extremely important, of course, as well. That's part of the brand reputation of the company. Utilizing, you know, the banks from recommended authentication. So where you have a banking partner, make sure you're utilizing those standards that they have. They have two-factor authentication or aspects of learnings around passcode. We go to all our major banking partners to find out what's new, what type of fraud they've seen, what types of security incidents, and we apply it into our own infrastructure. So these aspects of that, you know, and there's aspects of fraud protection around positive pay or reverse positive pay. And the last one is due diligence on the companies you're doing business with, right? Whatever your partner is, we talked about aspects of working with partners that are not introducing risk. You know, how do you do your due diligence on those partners that you're working with? So just some basic guidance here in terms of measures of success, because we talked about digital transformation. We talked about this aspect of, you know, fraud protection, making sure you have proper security measures. You know, focusing on operational or strategic KPIs is extremely important. We talked about the change of the payroll administrator to focus on more strategic things. So aspects of data where you can get the cycle time, you know, the timeliness and submissions, remittances, understanding your payments error for payment. What's the time to respond to client inquiries? What does that look like? The number of inquiries you're having, days to resolve payroll error is another one. So if you think about where we're potentially adding more automation, where are we focusing on these things? You know, it's an increasingly important piece to look at these things as a measure of success, right? If you look at these types of statistics, it can actually lead to a better employee experience ultimately. And here's some additional ones around cost of a payroll system, average overall cost of producing pay statements. So just again, you know, things to focus on as we look to get more value added aspects from where the payroll administrator is going to look at as a measure of success. And that reflects then on your employees and how you're addressing their needs. So let's talk about what's next. So one of the things I just want to emphasize is on the data side. So we do have our ADP data cloud for analytics and benchmarking and embedded intelligence. This is in our product. So it actually allows you to get a lot of insight. We talked about these aspects on people analytics, right? And getting those insights and being able to get that delivered where it's through a mobile app or so on. It's this aspect of, you know, we talked about pay transparency as well. So having that aspect around diversity and equity and inclusion in the organization is extremely important. Enhanced insights as you look at your different locations that you may have for your business, you know, what type of metrics can you expose there in terms of turnover in particular areas or compensation or, you know, also understanding, you know, from a forecasting perspective where you might have employees that are turning over, potentially getting that insight in front of you so you can put a program in place that may help with retaining employees. So all these aspects where you can have organizational benchmarks, the more information you have And the more that you can forecast, the better your ability to control and provide better programs. And also, you know, in this state of things that we're in right now, where there's so much changing, you know, being able to get better insight is going to be important. And then embedded intelligence, right? We've talked about AI. You know, we've talked about aspects of, you know, ultimately machine learning, where we're potentially getting utilizing data to make better decisions. So, you know, a lot of our tools based on this data cloud integration can offer things like salary benchmarks. It can offer other insights in terms of things where they're missing, right? If it's aspects on management of your employees and so on, you know, late check-ins, things like that. There's a lot of embedded intelligence that can be utilized there. And then other aspects on the enhanced insight. So, you know, we talked about compensation analysis to make sure your organization is calibrated, you know, to the rest of the industry. And that's important as you look at your workforce, not wanting them to leave at all, making sure that it is at level. Organizational benchmarks to make sure teams are optimized and that you have organizational ability to make changes where you can. And then also turnover risk headlines, right? We're in a very an industry right now and a time where things are in a constant state of churn. So where we can get AI to help with being proactive in managing turnover, identify employees at risk is extremely important, and taking proactive steps to increase the job satisfaction. So that's really in flexibility, making sure that we're providing an associate experience that's that they value. Okay, I'm going to go through some very quick final takeaways, and then we'll go to questions, but I want to make sure we get to that. So we'll go to that just very quickly. So just to summarize a few points from the session today, embrace artificial intelligence, right? It gives us a way of solving human problems, but make sure you're not doing it for technology's sake. It really should be solving a problem, not for the sake of testing technology. We talked about that increased demand from the gig economy. You know, understanding the preferences of the new workforce is going to be extremely, extremely important as we look to bring in new talent and retain talent. That increased demand for financial wellness, making sure those are included in employee support systems. You know, employees are going to be expecting more and more from their employer in terms of helping them manage their financials to reach their goals. And so it's our responsibility to help with that. We talked about pay transparency, so more and more options around pay, and then improved data security. We talked about some of the aspects where you can look at your current processes and make sure that you're keeping things up to date and are aware of what's happening in the industry to make sure you're protected. With that, I thank you so much for the presentation today and allowing us to present. We'll open it up to questions for myself and Jeff. So let's go ahead and do that.
Here, I've made lots of notes. Great presentation. I know I wouldn't be doing ADP Canada justice if I did not mention our Insights at Work podcast. Look no further than when you are looking for the newest topics in HR and business, check out anywhere that you stream or listen to your podcast. You can always check out the Insights at Work podcast, but let's answer some questions. So I'll give you a quick break and I'll answer this first one. And it's from Cameron. And Cameron's asking, who do you consider your competitors and enablers to support the gig economy? Cameron, I'll answer that one because I'm on the communications team, and the answer is always, well, we're very unique and we don't have any competitors. But what is really awesome about ADP, and it's Khadir talked about this data cloud, and we gather so much information and we can present it back to our clients, and then we can benchmark it against industry and sectors and aggregate this data. That is a huge differentiator, and that really helps our clients measure what they're doing. But let's look at a couple other questions. So I know Michael and John had a couple really great ones. So I'll ask the first one. This one's from Michael. He's asking Khadir, do you foresee payroll providers paying via cryptocurrency of choice in the near or medium future, or are regulations and potential regulations a barrier?
Yeah, it's a great question, Michael. So absolutely. I think there is a request from, employees to ask their employers what they're doing around that. And it is a very much a developing landscape. And if we look at it, is it, you know, some people assume, is that just Bitcoin? But no, there's aspects where other types of cryptocurrencies are out there. I'll say in some companies, I know Google and Facebook, they do have providers that can integrate them to provide some of those options. And ADP, of course, wanting to stay at the cutting edge of these types of things, we're also looking into it. But to your point, there is aspects of like legislation, depending on where you are. There's aspects on legal. So I think it's continually evolving piece on cryptocurrency. I think it's really an aspect where we're still doing evaluation because, you know, we talked about compliance and the importance of that. We want to make sure what we're putting in the hands of our clients is extremely tested, safe, and providing that. But ultimately, I do think we'll get to a point where we'll be able to provide these types of options.
Now, Khadir, there's a question from John, and John's asking, I know that you're kind of passionate about this anyway. He's asking, do you expect cash usage to rebound? And if so, to what degree once the economy reopens?
Yeah, so I think with anything, when you get introduced with a change, I talked a little bit about that when I was talking about groceries, right? When there's convenience in what you do and you've been exposed to it. So now I'm aware that I can use Apple Pay. I may have not provisioned the credit card on my phone before because I still have to take out my phone and tap it, right? So it's still an aspect of some work that I have to do. But once it's done, right, you've taken that step, it becomes something I'm going to instantly do. And of course, you can use your Apple Watch, you can use other devices, right? Android, you might have your device, you have your cards provision there. So I think it starts to become the default behavior that you use. So the aspect of moving backwards, if you think about physical cash, I don't see it as much, right? I mean, you know, this aspect of, if I look at my wallet right now, there's no cash in there. Do I see myself changing that behavior once we get out of this pandemic? Probably not, right? If I can use a card to tap, that's going to be a much easier experience than handling that physical currency. So I do think, you know, and that's there's some aspects where I think there'll be nuances around that. But ultimately, I think, you know, we're not going to return back to the same thing. So there'll probably be people still using cash, but it's going to be, I would say it's going to be less. And of course, you know, the Insights at Work podcast is going to be a great place to just sort of observe some of that as we get to more recovery. So it's just a plug for you, Jeff. You know, I love you. There you go.
Did you want to share us your driver's license photo and your bank card while you got your wallet out there? All right, let's go to the last question. With respect to access to pay, are employers going to be expected to finalize payrolls with increasing frequency?
Yeah, so I think what it is really this aspect of the optionality around that, right? So if we think about, you might have your payroll cycle, it might be delivered on a certain time frame, right? Maybe it's mid-month and end of month. So I think those things will still continue, but the optionality to be able to be paid on a non-cycle payroll, that will increase, I do believe, right? Because we've talked about this in terms of the pandemic, the aspect of emergency funds has become important for a lot of workers, particularly those new workers then may have bills to pay and so on. So I think we'll still continue around traditional aspects of pay cycles, but the ability to request, we talked about request to pay, but request your payroll, the access to the earned funds that I've earned over the time that I've been working, I think that's gonna become more and more common and something that awesome. We're gonna see more in the industry.
All right, those are all the questions. Thanks so much everybody for joining us today. Really appreciate your time, Khadir. Great presentation. We'll talk to everybody soon. Everybody, enjoy your conference.
Great. Always a pleasure. Thank you very much, everyone. Thanks for attending.